42 years.
The views and opinions of the guest and host you hear on 1010 WOLB
are not necessarily those of the staff and management of Radio 1, its sponsors, or advertisers.
To everyone, every Friday here on 1010 WOLB from 10 to 12 is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. et al. Show with co-host, attorney Tehma Smith Wilson.
Good morning, Baltimore and beyond. Thank you for joining us again on another Friday. I am Tehma Smith Wilson. I'm an attorney and business owner based out of Baltimore City. The services that we offer include real estate and estate planning. So if you need to buy or sell your property or purchase your ground rent or create or update your will or your deed, please give us a call at 667-334-7242. 667-334-7242. And if you would like to be a part of the conversation today and you want to text a question or a comment, please text it to 667-334-7242. And as always, if you missed a broadcast, you can find us on YouTube at Frank Conaway Senior Show. That will list all of our past broadcasts. You can listen to it on your phone, your computer, or your television.
All right. What else is on your mind? It ought to be a whole lot on your mind today now.
There's been a lot going on in Baltimore City, so I look forward to discussing it all. And today's special guest is going to focus on men's health since it is National Men's Health Month.
Wow, great. Yeah. And our other co-host, attorney Robert Bob the Dean Dashiell.
Good morning, Baltimore. Another day closer to the 50th anniversary of my beginning to practice law in Maryland and Pennsylvania. My number is 410-547-8820. I specialize in procurement matters and contracting and commercial litigation.
All right. Well, I hope y'all know I'm going to work y'all today. Oh, yeah. It's hot today. Yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas of the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. If you need our services, telephone number to call is 410-669-1738. Specializing in at-need, pre-need, pre-arrangement seminars, veteran benefits, veterans, please get your DD-214, cremations, and you know the drill. Everybody ought to get some insurance or increase what you got. Several announcements. First, the viewing for Mrs. Phyllis Sewell, an icon of the Turner Station community, will be today from 4 to 7 at the New Shiloh Baptist Church, 105 East Avenue, with services tomorrow, the wake at 9:30 and the funeral at 10 a.m. at New Shiloh Baptist Church, 105 East Avenue. Arrangements by the Carlton C. Douglas Funeral Service, PA. Also, on this Sunday, I got to pull it up on. Oh, here it is. This Sunday at the, what's the name of the church here? Well, the church is located at 7515 Harford Road. There is an organ recital by one of the finest pipe organists, not only in this city, but in this country, as far as I'm concerned, and that's Dr. Kenneth Dean. And that's going to be this Sunday, June 11th at 4 p.m. At the 7515 Harford Road. But the name of the church is Asquith Presbyterian Church. Okay, it's the Asquith Presbyterian Church, and it's located 7515 Harford Road, and it's this Sunday at 4 p.m. Now, on Saturday, June 17th, Roots of Scouting, that's Leo Burrows and that group, are having Jazz in the Sanctuary Saturday, June 17th from 12 to 3. This year it's at the St. James Episcopal Church. I may as well say the historic St. James Episcopal Church, 829 North Arlington Avenue at Lafayette, featuring renowned keyboard artist, and I'm telling you, he is renowned, and I'm talking about Patrick Alston. I went last year, and the concert was just simply fantastic and fabulous. And anybody know anything about the Alston brothers, that's J.D. and Patrick, no, they are two of the finest keyboard artists Baltimore has ever produced. And that's June the 17th from 12 to 3. Tickets are $40 and includes jazz concert and a hot lunch. And you can contact Claude Artis at 443-492-8543. That's 443-492-8543, or Leo Barrows at 443-651-2578. That's 443-651-2578. And on January the 24th, that's the week after Father's Day, that Saturday from 12 to 4, there will be a fish fry given by the men at the Gillis Memorial Christian Community Church, 4016 Park Heights Avenue. The menu will be catfish, lake trout, and whiting. The sides of sweet potato, string beans, and potato salad, and cabbage. If you get the catfish, it's $15. If you get the other fish, it's $12. And that's on the 24th, June 24th, Saturday, 12 to 4 p.m. And we'll give you about the House of Prayer craft feast on the second hour. All right. We have, as she has most diligently been doing, bringing us great guests, giving us most important information. We have another guest today, and I'm going to turn it over to my co-host, Attorney Tehma Smith-Wilson, to introduce that individual.
Right. Good morning once again, Baltimore. June is National Men's Health Month, and we want to dedicate a segment to the men in our lives this month, especially since Father's Day is next week. The purpose of National Men's Health Month is to raise awareness about preventable health problems and encourage early detection and treatment of diseases among our men and boys. With that being said, today in our News You Can Use or Information for Dissemination segment, we have Dr. Sharon Baucom-Myers. Baucom-Myers is a primary care specialist with more than 30 years of combined experience in family medical practice, correctional leadership, and public health. She has served as chief medical director for departments of correction in three states, Kansas, Georgia, and Maryland. And Dr. Myers currently serves as a physician, too, at the Baltimore County Department of Health and Human Services Chronic Disease Prevention Unit. Good morning, Dr. Baucom-Myers. How are you doing today?
Good morning. Good morning, and thanks for having me.
Not a problem. Thank you for joining us. When it comes to men's health, what are the most important things that we need to know or should understand?
Well, thank you for asking that question. I think we need to understand that we've got a lot of work to do. Unfortunately for African-American males, the health of black men consistently ranks lowest across nearly all groups in the United States. And what I mean by that is, let's say the average life expectancy of males in America is 76 years. For women, it's 81 years. Black males in Baltimore, it's 72 years. When it comes to health, men might be perceived as a physically stronger gender because they're bigger and more muscular than women. But when it comes to health, it's the other way around. Men are more likely to experience chronic health conditions earlier than women because of different lifestyle, biology, and social factors. They include, you know, like smoking, alcohol, substance use, but stress and lack of exercise. African men, 56% of them are overweight. Black men are 30% more likely to die from heart disease, 60% more likely to die from stroke, and they're 9 times more likely to die from AIDS. So hidden in plain sight is the lack of health data on black men, and it's because there are differences in the attitude of health professionals and society at large when it comes to taking a look at what health issues are affecting African-American males.
You touched on a few elements in terms of men lifestyle, in terms of drinking and smoking and things of that nature. What are some of the key elements, things that they can do to live a better overall healthier lifestyle?
Well, certainly the fried fish and the barbecue and the red meat are dietary discrepancies that lend itself to unhealthy outcomes related to hypertension, stroke, and heart disease. So we need to take a look at less red meat, less fried foods, and look at a more plant-based diet. We've got to get more physically active with ourselves and our families, especially males, weight loss and stopping smoking and decreasing alcohol is important. But stress management, I mean, African-American males in all age groups are more likely to have depression, undiagnosed stress issues that contribute to less well-being. But most of all, black men in all income groups are 50% less likely to have had a contact with a provider during the past year, even when they have health insurance. So we've got to move more. You know, heart disease has been the number one cause of death for 20 years across the country and in Maryland as well. And strokes, I mean, we talked about Jamie Foxx, but like high blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, tobacco use, illicit drug use contributes to strokes. We need to be more aware of pre-diabetes. You can stop type 2 diabetes by lifestyle changes we just talked about, but 8 out of 10 people don't even know they're borderline, and that's potentially reversible. And you can do a self-test the CDC offers to look at that risk. With cancer, which we're going to talk a little bit about, the top causes of cancer-related death, prostate, lung, and colorectal, we have to look at how much our diet and stress contribute to that. So I really do believe that when we look at men, especially African-American men, and their health factors, it's so intertwined in our generational choices of food and lack of activity and exercise.
Can you, Dr. Robert Dashiell here, can you talk a little bit about inflammation and the correlation, if any, between inflammation and stress and anxiety? And also, UCLA published a study recently that says that black men between the ages of 65 and 99 are more likely to die within 30 days of an operation. Can you address those things?
Well, let me address inflammation first. And you're right. We found out that there are so many different stimulus that create inflammation in our body. And, of course, our body creates its own army. We've got white cells that are designated to fight inflammation and infection. And sometimes they go into overreaction. And you know what the biggest contributor to that is? Sugar. So when we add additional sugars to everything that you see on the shelves these days, most people don't recognize. If you say no sugar is best for inflammation, no doubt about it. But if you add sugar, I mean, sugar impacts the same addictive center in the brain as opiates. So we've got people addicted to sugar, and sugar is one of the worst inflammatory stimulants in our body. If you think about your second part of your question, I would have to admit at this point in time, I don't have enough information. I can certainly, after the our interaction, look at some possible resources for the second part of your question, but I regret I don't have that.
Okay, the second part, just to be clear, had to do with the relationship or correlation between anxiety, stress, and inflammation. Is that what you're saying you don't have data on at the moment?
No, I thought there was another part of the question.
There was another part dealing with the UCLA study that black men, older black men, are more likely to die 30 days after surgery. But if you don't, I understand you may not have that. But I'm really most concerned about anxiety, stress, and the correlation or connection to inflammation. And tell us, if you will, what inflammation really is.
So inflamed is the basis of inflammation, which means that instead of having a normal, regular sort of response to disease, your body goes into an over-response, an agitated, aggravated response. So what happens is anxiety creates a trigger in the fight or flight system of your hormones, your adrenaline. Mm. And unfortunately, the fight or flight stimulation for the body, even though it's protective, is not a healthy state to be in chronically. Mm. And as such, your body interprets that as an attack and continues to put out the kind of hormones designed to fight that attack, which are not helpful and are usually destructive at a cellular level to the mechanisms that the body has for normal hemostasis.
Thank you. And one of the issues that are prevalent amongst African-American men, and I know that when I first got on the show, impromptu, we had a conversation about prostate cancer and men who have been through prostate cancer and the type of treatment they had received. But just with some general statistics from Zero Prostate Cancer Organization, 1 in 6 black men will be diagnosed with prostate cancer in their lifetime. Every 13 minutes, a black man is diagnosed with prostate cancer, and every day, nearly 17 black men die from prostate cancer. Can you give us some information on prostate cancer in the African-American community?
I'd be happy to. As you stated, most people don't. Let's just talk. The prostate is a gland. And it's a necessary gland. It adds fluid to semen and sperm produced by the testes through your urethra, which is the tube that goes from the bladder. During intercourse, it aids in the ejaculation of sperm and reproduction. Because it's located below the bladder and in front of the rectum, it's about the size of a walnut. But because of its location, I think that most people will think about a digital rectal exam as a barrier to African-Americans and men in general seeking some sort of treatment. But because, as you stated, African-American men are at an increased risk for developing prostate cancer over white males and other men of color, and because they're less likely, because of maybe unconscious bias and racism, to be diagnosed until there's some part and consistency related to advanced disease. So I think what's important is early prevention. If black men are harmed by racial bias in preventive care and are less likely to be offered the option of having that prostate PSA test, then we need to take advantage of organizations that are mentoring African-American males through this battle. And prevention starts with education. And that early detection is the key, because if you think about it, race is a risk factor, family history is a risk factor, and this diagnosis, diet, your age, genetics even, and chemical exposures, which is why veterans, black veterans, have a 1.5 times greater risk of prostate cancer. Since the majority of that cancer presentation are for men over 50, it's important to start education about the risk earlier. And that means that we really have to have that kind of discussion with a close relatives who've had prostate cancers, or friends, because if we don't, then they're less likely to look at that examination as a critical component of longevity. And if we've said that those top cancer causes of death in the United States are prostate, lung, and colorectal, then it's important to have that conversation. I have 4 sons, and I've already had that discussion with them, and they're in their early 40s, because their father, their uncle, their grandfather, and their great uncle all were diagnosed with prostate cancer in their early 50s. So if they go to a provider saying, well, you know what, I need to wait before I offer you this test or this exam, they need to be empowered and prepared to advocate for themselves. And that comes through information and knowledge, like you're doing today.
Dr. Carlton Douglas here. I'm going through that very situation right now. My doctor has found, and I don't have no problem telling him, because I want men out there to get checked. Especially black men, have found that my prostate is double the size it should be. Now, fortunately, there has not been any cancer found, but there is a procedure that he has recommended me to get in the very near future that could possibly relieve some of this. But my question to you is, are there any studies showing why prostate cancer is more prevalent in black men than it is in men of other persuasions?
Well, first of all, thank you for sharing, and that generosity with respect to sharing your battle and the information surrounding your particular clinical status is what's important for black men to share with other people. So thank you for doing that. I think that one of the things in some of the studies that's found that African-American men who are diagnosed with early stage prostate cancer were less likely than white men to receive any type of treatment for that cancer. And in fact, they were less likely than white males to be offered the option of even having the screening test, the PSA, much more likely than white men to be told that the benefits of the PSA test were uncertain. The interesting thing for me is that whether it's black men or men of all races, when the disease is caught early, the rate of survival increases to over 99%. And a 5-year relative survival rate for black African-American men diagnosed with prostate cancer at any stage is 97%. But once it's advanced, the 5-year survival rate for men with prostate cancer is 32%. So education, information, and advocacy, self-advocacy, related to dealing with providers, choosing providers who understand the cultural differences and biases related to the approach to the management of this disease, is critical.
Doctor, following up on Carlton's question relating to why prostate cancer may be more prevalent among black men, it is also a fact, I think, that black people generally are underrepresented in all clinical studies, which, depending upon the degree of underrepresentation, could lead to false conclusions with respect to the percentage or the prevalence of the particular disease within that race. Have you taken that into account, or has that been a factor in your conclusions?
Absolutely. And in fact, it's just not my conclusion. Dr. Roland Thorpe of Johns Hopkins University speaks about the lack of research and data specifically about the unique health needs and challenges of black men. And he's got a black men's health project that's been led by a coalition of black male researchers who are taking a look at a survey, which Black Men's Health Project website. You can take this survey, and it's a coalition that's trying to address 10,000 men 18 and older to determine culturally sensitive strategies to decrease the health disparities that you talk about, because we just don't have enough health data on black men to develop more proactive strategies to help abort the higher incidence and death related to prostate cancer. So just going online to take the Black Men's Health Project, you take that survey, you're going to help these three African-American physicians, one's at George Washington University, Michigan State, get that survey of 10,000 men, African-American men, asking the questions, why do you not go and seek care earlier? Is it discrimination? I mean, we talk about Tuskegee, and it seeps into the culture of today's, youth and ourselves. Who do you trust? Do they care about me? And then if you talk about black men and checkups and that digital rectal exam, well, they're working on, and they have a urine test instead of the digital rectal, along with a blood test of the PSA. But I think, just as you stated, we have to have, and that's why these African-American physicians have taken on the business of making sure that there's enough good health data on African-American men so we can develop better strategies and interventions so that they don't go along the continuum of not being able to get the best care earlier and sooner.
Which leads me to the next question. By the way, I have heard Dr. Thorpe. I think it's Thorpe.
Yes.
And I've sat through his presentation with his colleagues, and so I'm familiar with his work and their work. But my next question is, what information can you share with respect to who controls the process by which individuals are invited to participate in clinical studies, or the process of selection of individuals to participate in clinical studies? Because I'm concerned about black men who don't go in for, or who may not go in for, but those are not the ones who we're talking about that are the subject of the clinical studies. These people are generally, or many of them have been invited to participate in clinical studies not related to the course of treatment that they may be presently undergoing.
Well, certainly the makeup of the clinical investigator team may influence your participation, and a general overall mistrust of the medical system in general. I think during COVID, there were a number of stories of African-American folks being turned away, and their symptoms weren't bad enough to stay in the hospital. And I think our history is riddled with examples and reasons for there to be some extreme caution with respect to what those studies are eventually. Is it an unbiased study? Who has that data? And I think when it's like FUBU, for us, by us. And so this is an opportunity through the Black Men's Health Project, I think, to hopefully avoid some of the pitfalls of people not wanting to sign up for clinical studies because of mistrust and concern about what that information, will it be twisted, will it be unbiased? And I think we have to continually work to allay those fears.
And even with all this great information that you're giving out today, a lot of men might still be hesitant. What are some of the symptoms of prostate cancer that if men experience, they should see a doctor right away just to get checked out?
Well, during the early stages of prostate cancer, there usually are no symptoms.
Right.
That's why screening and yearly checkups, which are not something African-American males routinely do, but they're very important in catching the early stages of this disease before it spreads outside the prostate. There are people who have urge to urinate more immediately than they used to. Before, maybe they didn't have to get up and pee at nighttime, and now they're frequently doing it. Sometimes they have that initial difficulty starting the urine stream, or it's weaker, or it's dribbling after they've finished. They may have some difficulty getting an erection or pain when ejaculating. Or if they start to have maybe more urinary tract infections, those are things to seek medical attention related to it. The more serious cancer symptoms could be unexplained weight loss, fatigue, anemia, pain in the lower back or pelvic area. I think it's easier to mistake prostate cancer for benign prostatic hypertrophy. And the gentleman had talked about his prostate being larger, but it's not cancer. But it could create overactive bladder symptoms, the frequency and urgency. So again, it's critical that you seek some attention when your pattern of urination or your stream or some pain occurs. And not to be afraid, because for the most part, the best thing you can do is get in there and get a diagnosis that, hey, you know what, your prostate's just boggy, we're going to follow it, and we're going to do this blood test, we're going to get a family history, and I hope that if it's not a physician who seems to be interested in helping you navigate that, ask somebody about someone who they've gone to, who's a provider who's willing to listen and be your partner in going through that journey and discovering that, for the most part, you're probably going to be fine. But if you're not, then that's the person who's willing to be that partner with you as a provider that you should find.
And can you go over some of the various treatments? I know when we discussed this earlier on the show previously, a lot of men called in and said that they had prostate cancer and they were treated by proton therapy, which might be less invasive than an actual surgery cut process. So can you go into like the more traditional or the more common treatments versus, you know, the new technology that might be available?
Well, first of all, I want to make sure that everyone knows that each case is unique and should be treated as though there's nobody in there but you, meaning there's so many treatment choices. And when you start to learn about the options for your prostate cancer, the website that you referenced, Black African Americans and Prostate Cancer, Zero Prostate Cancer, a wealth of information and common questions are addressed at that website. But because there are so many different treatment choices, and the people who are specialists in that usually are the urologist, that's a super specialist who's done extensive training and working with prostate and male genital urinary system. You also have radiation oncologists who have been trained to specifically address the different treatments and modalities. So the standard treatment, of course, is active surveillance. That means that there's someone who is not only getting your digital rectal, your blood studies, your urine studies, but are tracking it with you and measuring the trend of those the studies specifically to the prostate gland. You can have a surgery. There's radiation therapy. There's hormone therapy, chemotherapy, immunotherapy, and ultrasound, cryosurgery, which is like freezing it. But if you talk about some of the newer approaches, whether it's a focused laser ablation, there are external beam radiation therapy. I think some people have talked about that as a proton therapy. You can plant uranium seeds, the implants of radiation therapy directly into or very close to that tumor. And you can do internal radiation and implant therapy as well. So I think whether it's proton radiation or focused laser ablation, not only does that website talk about the pros and cons, but most critically, it's what your urologist, your radiation oncologist, your teammates in the journey that you're going to take in battling that cancer. That's why those choices of those companions is so critical.
And my last question, I want to throw it out to you first, and then I want to throw it out to my co-host. What ways, because I know you said you have four sons and, you know, your husband, your their grandfather, et cetera. What ways have worked the most for you in terms of encouraging the African-American men in your life to go to routine annual checkups?
Well, thank you for that question, because it is a challenge. I'm an identical twin who's a doctor. I have a little brother who's since deceased who was also a doctor. So I think ganging up on people with male members to be able to not just say that you ought to listen to your mother, but be able to talk about some of their friends or the struggles they went through. And so to be able to say, you know, you don't have to just concentrate on that digital rectal exam. There are other ways to assess your condition without having to have like some of the cultural issues surrounding that. I also wanted them to understand that we need African-American meds to hang around longer. And when they have children, if there's a step that they could take that would add some longevity to their opportunity to interact and see their grandchildren, why wouldn't you take that step? And so whether it's the element of, am I going to lose my erectile function? Am I going to have to wear incontinent pads? I think the sooner that you address how low those rates are and what the alternatives are, the better. And so I use their uncles. I use their cousins. And I use some of their friends and fraternities who've gone through it as mentors to be able man to man to just talk about some of the things that as African-American males we can do better with.
Are you given, or did you in medical school, and I don't know if we ask or know where you went to medical school, but
I went to Kansas University.
Okay. Did you receive any particularized training during your course of study in medical school or do a subsequent internship or residency as it relates to the health conditions and disparities of black people?
No, I didn't. And so because common.
That's question. Do you know whether or not there is generally such training provided in other medical schools?
Well, you know, traditionally, historically, Meharry Medical School and Howard Medical Schools trained the majority of African-American doctors.
Right.
Yeah, that shifted a lot since affirmative action, and you'll find a lot of white physicians graduating from those schools as well.
Mm.
But the professors, the culture that are in traditional historical black colleges and institutions of higher learning certainly embrace and dictate and incorporate and weave in the fabric of the education of that resident or medical student what it is that black people in our culture and our culture competency, what they have to have in hand to be better providers for the people that they treat. In this case, the ones that look like them.
So, putting aside Meharry and Howard, it wasn't taught. It wasn't part of your course of study at Kansas. What about the white medical schools where the majority of doctors, black or white, still are trained? Or do you know whether or not such emphasis is available, such training is being made or a part of the experience in those institutions?
I think there is a call for cultural competency and for more training in unconscious biases, which means that there is a recognition, and not only in medical, but in workplaces as well. So I think that the movement toward an understanding of the culture of people, the biases that are kind of woven into our being as we traverse through society, that we're more consciously aware that those biases do play a direct effect on how we treat people. So yes, there are organizations, including medical schools, that are including as part of the curriculum cultural competency and unconscious bias.
Okay. Well, Doctor, we certainly want to thank first Tehma for getting you to come on and talk about something that is very important in the black community and especially the black men. You are welcome to come back at any time to discuss issues concerning, especially in this subject matter. I am glad to hear that they're trying to find something other than the digital rectal exam.
Absolutely.
Because I think that is, I really believe that is one of the reasons that turns off many of the black men from going to get examined. Not only black men, period.
I absolutely agree with you.
Yeah.
And there is a urine test coming.
Okay.
But let me thank you all as well. I am an unworthy substitute for our iconic Director of Health, Dr. Gregory Branch, and I bring you greetings on his behalf.
Yeah, he's a good friend. Good friend. Yeah.
Thank you, Doctor. You did an excellent job. We appreciate your wealth of information, and I know we've already scheduled to have you back, so we look forward to that.
Yeah.
Take care again.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
That was fantastic. Glad to have had that doctor on, and I hope, and let me just say to all the black men out there that are listening, they used to say started at 50. I'm recommending to you, if you have a primary doctor, you need to start getting tested at 40 to get it. And if you do not have a urologist, get one, which is their expertise on this particular issue. I know, I can tell you personally that it was many years before I decided to get the exam. What triggered it was my primary doctor did a blood test and the PSA came up high. And I didn't know what a PSA was. And when he explained it to me, that's when we started dealing with the situation right then. And I've been going through some battles off and on for the last several years. You got to get the fear out. You got to get the fear out. And don't be afraid. And go to your doctor. Have confidence in your primary and your urologist once you find one. And just listen to the options. If they find something wrong, listen to the options that you have to deal with this. And I'm telling you, you'll be around much longer than, because I'm telling you, the doctor scared me when she said, Bob, the average is around 73, 70.
I've been tested three times for rectal exams, and all I choose doctors by the size of their fingers.
Yeah. I ain't even gonna touch that one. I'm gonna leave that one alone there.
But let me say that you know, generally black people, and particularly black men, don't drill down, ask questions,
yeah,
find out, make sure that they're treating you and not the typical patient. Because the typical patient isn't you if you're black.
That's right.
And it's not hooked up in your computer, the computer that they use. Make sure that your doctor is treating you.
Yeah.
And ask questions.
Yep.
Ask questions.
Yep. Okay.
Never be afraid to get a second opinion and also take someone with you as an advocate. You know, it's always good to have a second set of ears.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. WOLB streams live at WOLBBaltimore.com. That means if you can't hear us too well on the radio, you can go to the internet and pick us up, or you can get the TuneIn app and just put in WOLB and pick us up. Now, we're coming to the lines because some of y'all been on here. We're going to come to Alan, Doc Cheatham, Carlos, Mark, and we got one line open, 410-481-1010. I'm going to take Alan real quick since he's been on so long. And then there's a whole lot of things I want to throw out here because this is a hot topic day. Alan, you on air?
Yeah, how you doing, Carlton?
All right.
Mr. Smith, the attorney, and Bob Dashiell, the attorney. Mm-hmm. No, you know, my uncle told me about prostate cancer. He was gray-headed in his 70s, 80s. He said, this is how he got my attention. That's what I'm telling to the black guy. All that luxury sex you have and all them ceiling fans and making a girl holler, all that kind of stuff. He said, you're wearing your organs down, and said, when you get 50 years old, you don't want to have prostate cancer. So I listened to my uncle, and I got tested at 50, and I just said this right here to answer that question. The white man ice is always colder. Because we got all these issues in our head. You got me? No. If the doctor, you have to feel comfortable with your doctor. Like you said, men or women. Because doctors are doctors.
Yeah.
That the white man ice is always cold. Let me ask you another thing. I'm going to go, Carlton. Mm. So you smart. Chuck Moran, would he work for Ice Cube because Ice Cube got that 3-on-3 basketball league? Now, what's his name? Silver? Adam Silver? Saying, I talked to you already. This your second time around. You're almost making $1 billion. Go down there and work for Ice Cube and see how much money he pay you. The white man Ice is always cold and is always attracted to us because it's a psychological thing.
Okay.
Silver and Ice Cube. Both of them are starting their own league, right? In charge of the league, right?
Yes. Ice Cube got that league with, I think it's with
3-on-3.
Yeah, 3-on-3. Yeah. Thank you, Alan.
See if John Moran can work for Ice Cube, because he ain't going to make no $1 billion working for the Ice Cube, a black man, because we tight with money, man. I can say that.
Thank you, Alan. Cap one line on 410-481-1010. When I come back to the phones, we're coming to Doc Cheatham, Carlos, Mark, Gloria. We got a line open, 410-481-1010. Okay, here's the hot topics today. The stepping down of Commissioner Michael Harrison from the Baltimore City Police Commission. People seem to be leaving the mayor's administration left and right. Two of them have been involved in the public safety, that being Ms. Jackson and now Commissioner Harrison. Police department is reported down by some 500 members. FOP is glad Harrison is gone. However, they seem to be a little overjoyed that Worley, who is being named as the interim commissioner, is coming in. now, is this racism at its best, or is it just that they know maybe have a thing for Worley a little better? He's from within, Mr. Worley that I'm talking about, the new interim commissioner, is from within the department. And we haven't had one in there since D'Souza. And, of course, he didn't last but 5 minutes before he was thrown in the clinker. Mm-hmm. The Supreme Court surprised everybody by upholding the Voting Rights Act against gerrymandering.
Gerrymandering.
Gerrymandering of black districts in Alabama. Which will also offset other states that are trying to do the same thing, such as Louisiana and Georgia. is this Supreme Court trying to make amends after the Roe versus Wade debacle, which has put its standing at an all-time low? Or is it because of Clarence Thomas's situation of embarrassing the court? And, of course, Clarence Thomas did not vote along for this right.
Well, he wrote a 48-page dissenting opinion.
48 pages.
48 pages.
Donald Trump is indicted, expected to present himself Tuesday in federal court in Florida, and possibly to be indicted in D.C. Also, first former president to be indicted. What does this say about the election? Pence has been cleared of his documents problem, still waiting on the decision of President Biden of his handling of the documents found in his possession. What effect will this have on the other Republican candidates for president? Will they still back Trump, or will they come out blasting Trump? And finally, the thing I want to throw out here is this merger of the PGA
and Live.
Yeah, and Saudi's Live taking over the formerly white-controlled golf sport, but is now owned by the Saudis, who ain't white, by the way. All right, let's go to Doc Cheatham. Doc, you're on air.
Good morning. Thanks so much for taking my call. Outstanding, outstanding interview that y'all did. I'm so pleased to hear it. I don't mind telling you, 16 years ago, I found it when I was with the NAACP, the Men's Blue Suit Health Awareness Weekend. It became an outstanding event. I'm sad to say that now that we have female health commissioners, we've not had that program for the last three health commissioners that we had. Hmm. It was a program that came under the NAACP when I was president. It had grown to such a great extent that the last year that we gave it, which was September 2010, there were over 250 mosque churches and organizations that had come on board with us. We need to bring it back, and I think that my possible death is something that kind of encouraged me to try to bring it back, that we need to get black men looking better after their health, talking to each other, because that's what it did. We did barbershops, we did churches, but it had grown to 250 organizations that had joined us to talk about, and I don't mind telling you, I borrowed the concept from the women. The women had blue suit health, and we created the Men's Blue Suit Health Awareness Weekend. I think we need to bring him back, and I would love to have this great radio show to possibly be the forerunner to bring it back.
Well, you put it out there, Doc. We'll back you on it.
I put it up on Facebook now. There was a big article that the Afro put out on September the 8th, 2010. And unfortunately, the female health commissioners we had haven't bought on to this idea.
Okay. Well, we appreciate you, Doc.
Thank you. God bless. Great show. I'd like to hear that show again.
Okay.
Thank you. See you.
All right, let's go to Carlos quickly because we're up against the hour. Carlos, Brother Carlos.
Yeah, I hope I can get all this in. On the prostate cancer thing, if you have an enlarged prostate, and I personal testimony is that mine was enlarged, and I had to go to Georgetown Medical through MedStar, and they have the experienced laser doctors over there to reduce the prostates, which worked out kind of good for me so far. And I just go for my annual checkup. Just threw that out there. Down this way, Carlton, I don't know whether you have heard of this, but it's in the air, not in my town, but right around here. There's a funeral director.
Yep. I knew that was coming. I knew it was coming. Come on.
Wilson Chavis is his name.
I know him. I knew his father well. His father was Wesley Chavis over here.
He's out of Washington, D.C.
Yeah.
And they were had a funeral arrangement or a funeral. They were putting this young lady, burying this young lady, and he shot a rival funeral director and killed him.
No, no, no. He did not shoot the rival. He shot the pallbearer.
The pallbearer was something that he was having an issue with.
He got into an argument with the pallbearer. There was an issue between him and another funeral home, okay? But the person that was killed was one of the pallbearers, and a lady was shot also.
Yeah,
I know all about the deal. I wasn't going to bring it up, but since you brought it up, yes, I am aware of it, and we're still getting more information on that as we speak.
Yeah, he lives down in the Hughesville area.
He's up in Upper Marlboro with his operation. Yeah.
I'm trying to get more information.
Yeah.
The final comment is that...
Well, if we have time, because we got a little more important issues to deal with today, but if I have any time, I will give you some information on what I've heard and, and take it from there.
Okay.
Thank you. All right. We got Mark and Gloyd, and we got several lines open. Now, Mark and Gloyd, I want you to hold on, because we're getting ready to go into commercial status. And if you want to call in 410-481-1010. That's 410-481-1010. And don't go anywhere. We got a lot of topics on the plate today about the commissioner, about Trump, about this deal that went down with the Saudis and the PGA after the PGA even threatened their members about going over playing for LIV. And a whole lot of stuff going on. So don't go anywhere. Every Saturday from 10 to 12 here on 1010 WOLB is the Frank M. Conaway Sr. NL Show with co-host attorney Tehma Smith Wilson, attorney Robert Bob DeShields, and yours truly, Carlton C. Douglas. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back, and we got two lines open if you want to call in 410-481-1010. His mother goes to scrub the floors for many, and you best believe she hardly gets a penny. Living just enough.
Talk in the day. So.